When it comes to the evolution of life on Earth or other planets, the general rule is that probabilities decrease with increasing specificity. The more specific a life form, the less likely it is that it will evolve naturally. That doesn't mean anything more specific is implausible, but just that we can expect it to be less common in the universe. No matter what, we can be certain about one thing: life will start out tiny. From mere molecules to minute microbes, life on any exoplanet far, far away will probably be stuck at microscopic scales at first and remain so for eons. That is because, starting from such humble beginnings, evolving creatures need to achieve key innovations in order to break through into the macroscopic world. So what are some of the strategies employed by living systems during evolution to attain ever greater sizes, and is there a single universal trend to be discerned? Let's find out. Any planetary biospheres out in the universe will expectedly go through a natural development in which there will be predictable and unpredictable events. When doing speculative biology, the challenge is to sort out which are predictable and thus bound to happen, and which are not. And the more specific a particular creature design, the less likely it may be for it to appear again elsewhere because of all the conditions required for it occurring in the right order. In contrast, the eventual genesis of single-celled organisms out of proto-biological chemistry is much more predictable, and this is why. All life will initially start out on the tiniest scale conceivable, the molecular level. And for any self-replicating molecule, gathering enough chemical components needed for the assembly of another copy of itself is, in principle, just a matter of time. However, the passage of time also increases the chances of its destruction. So, to speed up matters, a self-replicator may want to start producing other molecules like enzymes to act as little minions to aid it in its quest to take over the world. But it would be nice if everyone stayed together. So the adoption of a form of container around all of this, taking care of just that, would be advantageous and give an edge over the competition. Life on Earth co-opted a special kind of naturally occurring lipids that can form membranes as containers for metabolic processes. In time, a dependency developed on this cellular structure, achieving something we could call a single-celled organism or microbe. And it is highly likely that life elsewhere will do the same or something very similar. But there are very obvious restrictions to size for microbes. Just increasing cell volume defeats the whole purpose of having a membrane in the first place, as the concentrations become too low for metabolic processes to be effective enough. Also, nutrient uptake from the surroundings will suffer due to the growing surface-to-volume ratio. So life will always start out microscopically and stay small for quite a long time, enough for establishing dominance of any early biospheres. Single-celled life will monopolize resources, and microbial mats will trap vital minerals in the underlying substrate, as well as diminish oxygen levels above and below. This will probably universally result in what I call microbial phase biospheres. For a long time, biospheres like this will remain in a sort of stalemate. The paradox is that in order for active macrofauna to evolve in the first place, you need active macrofauna with adaptations for working through sediments. So how can primordial life forms increase their relative size and get the revolution started? Well, first of all, by using or rather reusing what they've already got: membranes. Membranes can be folded inwards as to compartmentalize different metabolic processes. On Earth, these developments made microbial cells ever more complex and eventually led to the eukaryotic cell, the building block of plants, fungi, and animals. For instance, to make enzyme production more effective, a microbe's genetic material could become enveloped by a special internal membrane, thus forming a nucleus. Other important processes to be compartmentalized are those related to energy production. And this is where interesting developments took place early in the evolution of eukaryotes. The assimilation of other microbes to act as a kind of household servant. Oxygen-burning microbes were turned into the internal power plants known as mitochondria. Photosynthesizing microbes became the chloroplasts inside the cells of plants and algae. This phenomenon is called endosymbiosis and essentially resulted in cells within cells. Transport of materials in these supercells is taken care of by a network of membranes called the endoplasmic reticulum, combined with a protein scaffolding formed by so-called microtubules. This system enables more control over what goes where, rather than relying on mere diffusion. And with many cellular processes having become bound to membranes in the first place, the greater surface area will then also lead to increased production and wider distribution. All this complex machinery allows for cells that can grow substantially bigger. In another video, I will speculate on other ways to achieve the same kind of complex cell. But for now, let's move on to the next level. Because not even a eukaryotic cell can become much larger without additional techniques. One obvious way is simply duplicating and spreading vital structure into a larger volume, known as a cenocyte. Macroalgae like Caulerpa or Velonia and plasmodial slime molds are examples of such creatures with a continuous multinucleate cell. But there's a better way to outgrow unicellular mediocrity that also offers greater flexibility. As a complex, self-contained module, the entire cell itself can be duplicated and reused. And in everything from biology to human technology, modularity is what enables ever higher levels of complexity. I'm talking, of course, about multicellularity. Duplicating the same complex structure over and over again, while varying, specializing, and arranging behavior and properties, can obviously lead to many innovative solutions. This especially goes for microbial cells, and multicellularity has evolved many times over in different lineages of life, perhaps starting as simple colonies of cells clumping together. By secreting fiber-forming molecules, cells could be glued together into what is called an extracellular matrix, which literally means a lattice or fabric outside of the cells. However, cells need a couple more key adaptations to really get up and running. Like how the Lego brick caused a toy revolution with their interlocking nubs, the microbial ancestors of animals had to evolve specific molecular connections in order to coalesce into cohesive units or tissues. And once cells became able to form tissues, this opened for a wealth of new possibilities. When these cellular aggregates learn to form a cohesive mat by dividing mostly laterally while resting on a dense matrix, they formed a special kind of tissue layer known as an epithelium. A tissue like that is essentially a membrane of a higher order that can fold around and thus contain a fluid-filled cavity in its own turn. The immediate advantage of this would be a dramatic increase in size compared to merely a tight clump of cells. Not unlike these Volvox algae. And this is quite effective as a form of protection against predators with a minimum number of cells needed, all while new colonies can be formed in the safe space inside. An interesting parallel to this is the defensive circle that musk oxen create around their young. But it doesn't stop there. A creature consisting of cohesive tissues has the capacity to keep on growing while retaining overall shape and properties, like a balloon being inflated. You can compare it a bit with those gummy bear candies, which will swell by drawing in water while preserving form, color, and taste to some degree. In a similar way, a multicellular blob can simply grow by increasing its internal volume while adding more cells on the outside, both laterally but also out or inwards, if need be. The next step is specializing different areas of the tissue layer to suit various functions. Single-celled organisms often already have diverse cell types at their disposal, manifested during different phases of their life cycle. For instance, the percolozoa have an amoeba phase when food is plenty, a flagellate phase for migrations, and secrete tough outer walls while staying dormant during harsh times. These cell phases could be marshaled as distinct cell types in multicellular creatures. Some cell types could provide movement while others work on digesting any food encountered. A third cell type could migrate inwards to provide internal structure by secreting tough materials in between. Animals with this really simple configuration actually exist, and they're called plecozoans. At this stage, tissues have become modules in their own right, but do need some kind of polarity for determining which way is up, down, or perhaps even forward. Groups of certain types of cells can also start to fold inwards, creating internal organs like a digestive cavity or gut. Or they can fold outwards, making external body parts like tentacles, gills, or limbs. Different tissue types can come together, forming whole organs, giving our evolving creatures yet another modular level for even greater possibilities. But just like with a single cell, above certain sizes, creatures start running into troubles again and will need organs specialized in respiration and circulation of vital substances. As higher level modules, organs themselves can be made to appear at a specific spot on the body or even be duplicated at multiple spots. Organs can also be organized in organ systems, yet another level of module, and when laid out in repeated serial patterns, the body can be extended into even greater sizes. This phenomenon is called metamerism or seriation, and lies at the foundation of the segmentation seen in arthropods and annelids, as well as the series of vertebrae and ribs in our own bodies. So thinking about the modularity of living systems really reveals its fractal nature, with repeated elements being organized by nesting variations into ever larger frameworks. Starting from the mere need for a membrane to make duplication more efficient, different kinds of membranes enabled larger and more complex cells. Complex cells were then grouped together in specific ways in order to form tissues. Various tissues came together to form complex organs. And organs can be gathered into organ systems and body parts, which can then be repeated in various patterns to create complicated body layouts. In the next video, I will discuss deep body patterning and the enormous possibilities we'll then have at our disposal for designing naturally evolved creatures. For now, please leave a comment. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and click the bell icon, and I'll see you next time. Cheers and bye-bye.